Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see so much fellowship going on. People just want to talk. I want to welcome you here new to our service this morning. If you have any visitors, please be welcome. Hopefully, we've made ourselves make you welcome. The only thing we ask is there's a little card in a pew in front of you, a visitor's card. If you fill it out, just put it in the collection plate when it comes by in the offertory. We would appreciate that. That just allows us to track you down. No, it allows us to maintain contact with you. I mean, that's the whole thing about church of fellowship and a sense of being part of the congregation. I want to direct everybody's attention to the announcements in the bulletin. As far as other announcements, does anybody have an announcement? I got one. Back on the, what do we call that?
Fellowship Point.
Fellowship Point. I'm going to call it Inspiration Point. The desk. There's a clipboard on there, and we have our mission outreach picnic coming up on the 29th of August. It's a Saturday between 11 and 1:30 in the over lunch period at Misty Glen. I talked about it last week. What I've done is I put a clipboard back there with little slots for things where you can help. Set up, clean up, take down, provide some side dishes, potato salad, mac salad, whatever, and cookies. Not desserts, cookies. We don't want cakes and pies. That gets kind of messy. We've got children's activities planned. We've got the Lions Club has volunteered to let us use their tent. We're going to use our table for it. It's going to be a big deal. This is a church event, not just a missions event. So I really need people to show up, even if you're not going to be doing something there. Please show up and meet people from our community and try to tell them what a great place Hebrew United Methodist Church is. So I'll be hitting it every Sunday from now until that time. Please put your name on the list. If not, I want to welcome our guest speaker today, Larry Works. Larry's been here in the past many times and is always entertaining. I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to hearing his sermon. He said it's concise, efficient, and short.
Pressure.
Yeah. So please, if you get a chance, if you haven't seen Larry after church, please walk up and tell them how great. I want to welcome you, Larry, and I guess your family's here with you also today. So we're looking forward to hearing from you later in the service. Okay.
Yeah, Grandma. Hey, welcome to worship this morning. We stand and sing with us.
It's in you, Lord, it's in you, it's in you. My life is in you.
with us as we cross the threshold into worship this morning. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Well, now that you all sat down. Please stand and greet each other with the peace of Christ and remain standing for the invitation of the first hymn. God, your changes touch our lives with mystery and hope. We hope to this place today, ready to see your power working through us. Help us to be open to your word and to answer your call among us. Through Jesus Christ we pray, amen. Please join me in our opening hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, 133, verses 1 and 3.
Sweet Lord Jesus, thank you for being here. Today we lift up joys, a lot of joys, reasons to celebrate. Also, tragic challenges, worries and pains that we have. And put into the bulletin announcements and requests for prayers. You are so awesome that those who are facing whatever life is doing to them, they don't have to say it with their words. You know already what's weighing on their heart and on their mind. And we lift those prayers, every concern, every joy up to you today. And as we lift those up, we ask, humbly ask, please put your blessing on this holy place, Hebrew United Methodist Church. This is a dynamic family that truly has a heart for your son. And we ask that your blessing be on every single person here, every single struggle, concern, worry about the future, worry about a job or lack of job, or underemployment, or where the next meal may come from. We learned today that the homeless average is 9 years old. Your children are hurting. We lift them up to you. We also lift up those that protect this country, those in the armed services, those that are firemen, policemen, they protect us while we're sleeping. We lift them up to you, as well as their families. Please protect them from all the harm and the criticism and all the darkness that may come their way. And as we're entering a new political season, we lift up all the leaders, regardless if it's a conservative, a liberal, a Republican, a Democrat, or check the box for a third, fourth, fifth party. We pray that you're able to open their eyes, and your wisdom, it flows through them. We're able to make righteous decisions that leads this country on a righteous path. And in the quiet of this moment, let's lift up our prayers to you. All of this we ask when Jesus taught us to pray a long time ago, when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Bring your gifts to the life-giving God. He will multiply them to send his message of love.
Or sometimes we can worry about, what else can we worry about? going into third grade, sometimes we worry about the workload, right? Because we know as school goes, we get harder. And sometimes we worry about that. Then that's all the things with school, but we got things we worry about in life too, don't we? So we're carrying all that around with us, and it's weighing us down just like our backpacks. But I have a song here for you that I'd love to read. And it's Psalm 68, verse 19. It says, "Praise be to the Lord, to God our Savior, who daily bears our burdens." What does that mean, that God daily bears our burdens? Does it mean that you need to carry all that around with you? All of your worries and all of your fears, do you need to carry that with you? No. Why? Why don't you have to carry that? Who's going to carry it for you? God is going to carry it for you. But you know what? You have to ask Him to. And even more than ask Him to, you have to trust Him to. You have to trust that God is going to do with your fears and your worries and all these things that are unknown about school and life. You have to trust Him to take those things, and then it'll be okay. And then He'll take those scary and fearful situations and make something good come out of that. Now, another good positive thing about unloading burdens is your backpack won't be so heavy and your hearts won't be so heavy. And one of the easiest ways to unburden yourself is to decide all the things that you're carrying around that you don't even need and that are leaving out room for the things that you do need. Now, I'm an expert backpacker, so I know I've got everything in this backpack that I need for back to school. And I don't think you're gonna find anything in here that's unnecessary, that's weighing me down, but why don't we check? Let's see what I've got. You guys wanna come and see what I've got? Let's see, oh, there's nothing in here. Maybe this one. See, that one's empty. I'm already looking good. I got room. All right, I've got Earth. There's her. And there's Ivy. They're coming to school with me because I need them for school, right?
No.
Like, no. What do you mean no? Well, that takes care of my friend problem if I bring my own friends, right? Okay, I don't need my pet snakes. All right, how about, oh, I've got my football. I need my football for school, right?
No,
that's not on the school supply list. Oh, for outside, so for maybe recess. But not my school supplies? All right, well, you hang on to that. All right, so maybe I don't need my football and, oh, I know, this is a good one. This is part of what's so heavy in my bag. I got Jenga for my Jenga class. We have Jenga class, right?
No.
No. I don't need that either? What else is in here that I don't need? Legos. Do I need Legos? I need Legos? No, I don't need Legos. Wait a minute, did I get the wrong school supply list? My race car? Do I need my race car? No? Uh-oh, I think I got the wrong school supply list. Oh, I got my potato masher.
No!
And I've got my pancake whisk.
No!
No? Well, maybe if I'm going to culinary school, but that's not where I'm going, is it?
Mommy, I don't need to school
labels. What else? What else? What else? Oh, my ice cream scoop? No. We have ice cream social class? Man, I think I did a bad job now. I got a game. I got another game. I thought we could play that when Jenga class ran over. And I got potato chips for when I get hungry. You know? Well, now if we take all this stuff out that I've been lugging around and hurting my back with all day, I don't have anything left. So you're telling me I filled up my backpack with all this stuff and I don't even have the right things I need? You know what that kind of reminds me of? That reminds me of our hearts and our minds. And what we were talking about fear. If we fill our hearts and our minds up with all this fear and all this worry, we don't have the good stuff. We don't have any room for the good stuff that God gives us, like His forgiveness and His help. And what else?
Well, Legos
can go with you. I didn't put it all back in my backpack. But we need to remember, we need to remember that we got to make room in our lives for all the good stuff from God, like His love. All right? Will you guys help me pack this back up, and then we're going to say a word of prayer? No, maybe after service I'll give you a snack. There, you put that in. Well, at least you guys like all the stuff I packed in my backpack. All right, let's take her. I think that's good enough. Will you guys hold your hands? No, let's put that in. All right, you guys hold your hands with me, please, so we can say a word for her. Thank you. Lord, help us to remember that we do not have to carry the heavy burdens of life around on our backs. Help us to clear our hearts and minds of the unnecessary things we are holding on to and give them to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A quality message. You don't need me. Bye, everybody. No, that was great. That was something we all can take away. Because you know, Baggage is not only a cheesy game show hosted by Jerry Springer on late night TV, which you shouldn't be watching, by the way. Don't he's gonna go looking for it. Yeah, I can tell that. but that was very poignant and meaningful, because we tend to carry a lot of garbage each and every day that we really don't need. Yeah, but yet we seem to pack it away. And I'll bite your potato chips, that is a necessity of life. Oh, I want to show you something here. It's kind of old, it's dingy, but it's a really cool looking little puzzle thing. It's a piece of plastic PVC pipe, but what you see is what you get. It's a piece of plastic pipe with four pom-poms. You have a blue pom-pom, a yellow pom-pom, a red pom-pom, and a white pom-pom. And as you can see, there's a long string that connects the blue, the yellow pom-pom, and a short string for the red and the white pom-pom. What does it do? Very simple. You pull the white pom-pom, the blue pom-pom becomes a high pom-pom, the white pom-pom becomes a low pom-pom. Then we pull the blue pom-pom, the white pom-pom becomes a high pom-pom, the blue pom-pom becomes a low pom-pom, which is really wild because you have a long string over here and a short string over there. Now, if you get really bored, you can do something different. You can pull the red pom-pom. Pull the red pom-pom, the blue pom-pom becomes a high pom-pom, the white pom-pom becomes a low pom-pom. Then when you pull the yellow pom-pom, the white pom-pom becomes a high pom-pom, and the blue pom-pom becomes a low pom-pom, which you know intellectually that the blue pom-pom has to be tied to the red pom-pom, fastened to the white pom-pom, connected to the yellow pom-pom, and tied to the blue pom-pom, which is almost impossible to say. And if you've been paying close attention, you've noticed there's a long string on one side, a long string on the other. You've never seen a long string on both sides until now. And you take this whole thing apart. There's nothing at home. There's nothing in the middle. Friends, let me tell you this. If you ever come across a puzzle like this, I encourage you, pick it up. When you go garage selling after the kids go to school, buy this. I guarantee a device like this will drive your friends, neighbors, family members, colleagues, co-workers, and literally anyone you know right up a pole. I brought this today because it's so much like Scripture. Reminds me of reading the Bible. Say what? Yes, it reminds me of reading the Bible. We sometimes we see the Bible, we see the words, we hear the words, but yet you're like, what in the world does that mean? You're so puzzled by it. And it leads to confusion. And all of a sudden, because you don't fully understand it, you start thinking, well, maybe the Bible contradicts itself. How can it say one thing or have this one feeling, but yet say this, which just goes against everything? Well, let me tell you this. If at any time you're reading your Bible and you feel the conflict, like it's contradicting itself, and it's not consistent, the problem is typically not with the Bible, but with the Bible reader. The problem is us. God is perfect. His word is perfect and infallible. It is all that and a bag of chips. It's us by not fully understanding what it says or the context in which it's written is where the confusion comes in. How often do we hear politicians' words taken out of context, right? Especially during this debate time. They're like, I didn't say that. This is the full sentence. You're like, oh, okay, now I understand what you mean. We have to understand and take a look at Scripture that same way. So we understand exactly what it means. But before we begin, let's pray. Heavenly Father, please wipe away all the concerns, the fears, the worries that we may be having and that we're carrying with us today. Wipe them clear so we can hear your word and the message that you have for us today. In your name we pray, amen. The Bible verse I chose today is one that is much like that. And it causes confusion to some people. Some people don't quite fully understand. And it's found in the book of Matthew. It's chapter 8, verses 18 to 22. And it all deals with the cost of following Jesus. When Jesus saw the crowds around him, he gave orders to cross to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Then another disciple said to him, Lord, first, let me go bury my father. But Jesus told him, follow me, and let the dead bury their own. This verse causes confusion with folks. And in some ways, as I'm going through this and pulling it apart, I know I'm preaching to the choir. But there's all bits and pieces that affect each and every one of us, even myself. Maybe we could find ourselves in these words. See, Jesus was at the very beginning of his ministry. And he was, he started out on a positive note, and he was a true rock star of the time. And in chapter 8 and 9 in the book of Matthew, he already delivered a groundbreaking, it was revolutionary Sermon on the Mount. He healed a man with leprosy during this little time frame. He had a Roman officer, to the Rome. He had to demonstrate his faith in Jesus. I mean, someone who worshipped the emperor, all of a sudden had faith in Jesus and God. He healed Peter's mother-in-law, which I think immediately she went to the kitchen and made them all sandwiches. Said something like that. He calmed the storm. He sends demons into a herd of pigs. He healed a paralyzed man. He heals a bleeding woman. He restores a girl back to life. And he even heals the blind and the mute. And all of this caused great attention. Think about it. Someone came to the neighborhood doing all that. You would get excited. Like, well, what is going on? And many folks are to flock around Jesus. And they had great vision. They were excited, elevating that rock star status. And I call these folks excited enthusiasts. An enthusiast is simply a person with a high interest. It can be a fan, it can be an admirer, a follower, and it can even be a groupie when you think about it. Groupies. They're excited enthusiasts. The Grateful Dead. Who are their groupies? Deadheads. I expect no less from the back row there. Thank you so much. Jimmy Buffett had the
Parrotheads.
New Kids on the Block. Blockheads. Very good. How about Neil Diamond? Yeah, he had groupies. He really did. I actually went to the concert. I was the only male that was like, I was like the only person under the age of 50. But they're called the Diamond Heads. And followers of Justin Bieber? Well, they're just late. But when you think about it, such followers, they're easily excited. They lose control of their senses. And they just get caught up in all the superficialness, and their excitement is almost self-serving. See, Jesus had many folks like that. They're approaching him with the idea of being added to the roster of followers. And in the middle of this excitement and all this attention, Jesus talks about the reality and the actual cost of following him. And that's what we cover in verses 18 to 22. The teacher of the law came to him and said, Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. A teacher of the law came to Jesus and said, Hey, I will follow you wherever you go. A teacher of the law. We don't know exactly who this person is, but it could very well have been a person much like Paul before his conversion. A Pharisee. Now, when you hear the word Pharisee, we get a knee-jerk reaction. Ooh, bad guys, right? But at that time, the Pharisees were highly regarded among the people. They were the keepers of the Mosaic Law. They actually lived out the Mosaic Law better than anyone else. And they would act out and actually teach the law. They were the keepers of the Jewish law. And this person was likely a person that was more comfortable to a comfortable lifestyle. But yet, in the excitement of all this, this person who understood the Mosaic Law better than anyone else said, Hey, I'm going to follow you, Jesus. And he wants to be one of his followers. And Jesus simply says, Hey, hold the cowboy. That's my unabridged version. He says, Foxes have dens, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. See, in other words, Jesus is telling this person that in spite of all this positive attention that I'm getting from people, it's not as glamorous as you think. See, following Jesus is at times the most challenging, the most uncomfortable, and the most difficult thing you may ever have to do. But the crowds were all caught up in the glamour. That's all they could see. See, it's much like the circus. You ever been to the circus? I love the circus. Now, many years ago, when I was on the road, I was a trucker like her. Now, I was on the road doing what I did, speaking, doing programs and whatnot. I had a good friend that was actually an entertainer with the Ringling Brothers Circus. And for a period of time, our schedules and paths crossed in Hartford, Connecticut, over there on the East Coast. And so we got to hang out a lot. And when you're on the road like that, they know a familiar face, a friend, that they can share the same concerns. And it's kind of nice to hang out with them and chat with them. But because of that, I was fortunate to see the circus from every conceivable angle. Backstage, front stage, top, I was all over that place. And trust me, what looks glamorous from a distance, sitting in your seat, eating your snow cone, is really pretty rough and difficult up close. And you find out what it's really like. And following Jesus is not without its own challenges. It's not easy. It's not always comfortable. And typically, it's not convenient. Jesus states that he had no place to call home. We might find that following Jesus is a sacrifice. It might cost us our own popularity, our own inner circles, our friendships, our leisure time, even the luxuries that we're accustomed to, we think we can't live without. And when these challenges start to come, they start to separate the excited enthusiasts from those that are committed followers. And people start to drop off and they realize it's not that easy sometimes. And then another disciple said to him, "Lord, first let me go bury my father." But Jesus told him, "Follow me," and then let the dead bury their own. Let the dead bury their own. Whoa, that sounds heartless, doesn't it? It's some straight talk from Jesus. And that can be challenging to us today. See, some might think that Jesus or the Bible is starting to contradict its message about love and honoring your parents. And it's a big tendency to take this passage out of context. See, this statement was directly applies to a person 2,000 years ago. And if we think that it applies to us today, literally applies to us today, that's where the problems come in. We have to understand the context in which it was said. See, back in the day, burying the dead could have lasted for literally a number of years. In the historical context of everything, I don't believe that this person was simply asking him for permission just to attend his father's funeral service like we do today. You know, you have a funeral come up, you drop everything, you go to it, you come back to life. You see, instead, this person could have been asking a number of cultural things. Exactly what, I don't know. But he was asking to, he was making a statement that he wanted to put following Jesus off until his elderly father died. And in the burial process, which could have taken over a year, because you know they bury them and then they dig them back up, dig the bones back up, and do something else with them. And it takes over a year to complete that process. Or perhaps the person was a firstborn son, and he wanted to make sure he staked his claim to his inheritance. Maybe he did not want to face his father's wrath, that he left the family business. A lot of family businesses back then, no Walmarts back there. But in leaving the family business to follow an itinerant preacher, this is the beginning of Jesus' ministry. For whatever the reason, be it money, financial security, family approval, if this person wanted to put Jesus on hold to attend his own personal agenda before following Jesus. See, at the time of this statement, Jesus was God in flesh. He was walking among us and living with us. Now here is a man that was standing toe to toe with Jesus. Whoa. Face to face with Jesus, the Son of God. And he was invited in person to join him to be a special follower. What does this man do? He puts the funeral of his father before they meet Jesus. As Jesus pointed out, the physically dead really don't care who buried them. This is just a shell for our time here on earth. And he's saying, let those that are spiritually dead take care of this task. Jesus was offering this man spiritual life and freedom. At this moment in time, this man had a unique and important opportunity that should not be wasted. This is not a passage telling Christians not to bother about funerals for their loved ones. It's a passage about priorities and excuses. Far too many people want a religion of convenience. And we start thinking about how people justify everything. And each and every person tends to create their own God to fit their own agenda. That's a God of creation, a God of convenience. It's not the God of creation. If you think about this, some of the excuses, I know I'm guilty of some of them, and I would say some of you are too. We've all said things like, well, I can't come to worship today. I got schoolwork. I got homework. I got things to prepare for on Monday, right? We have things to get ready for. But somehow we're able to watch the football game, right? Or go to the county fair. Or maybe go grocery shopping that exact same day. Wait a minute, you're too busy. But yet you have the time to do those things. Maybe your car needs new tires or maybe it's doing something here. But ironically, there's two cars in the driveway. They're both broken. We have a whole congregation here. People who are more than willing to give someone a ride to a church and a ride back home. And some of you actually need to slow down enough so they can get out and not fall. We're here. You have people who say that they can't go to church because they had an argument with their spouse. What better place to come? Remember, no Jesus, N-O Jesus, no peace, N-O peace. But to know Jesus, K-N-O-W, is to K-N-O-W, no peace. You're having a problem at home with a relationship. No better place than to come to church. And my favorite, I was out too late. I'm too tired. Oh, you're too tired for Jesus who stayed up all night, got himself whipped and beat and nailed to a cross. Yeah, go home and take a nap. We make these silly excuses. Now, I'm guilty of some of them. And I'm sure, if they're out back there, you probably said one earlier, didn't you? Yes, I thought. I'm glad I fucking do it. Because it's true. It's all of us. It's all part of our human nature. And we can begin to see what's more important in our lives, the lives of people. It's amazing how priorities start to shift. What would happen if you gave some of these excuses to your employer? Try to tell your boss, I don't come to work today because I was out too late. We should be unemployed real quick. But we continue to kid ourselves thinking that even though these excuses are not acceptable in the real world to our employer, a human being, somehow we think these excuses are acceptable to God. Again, it's all about priorities. That is what we should think about. If you have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to spend with God, which I think we all do, would other things demand your attention first? Would you ask God to wait a bit and then you'll get back to him? Right? Have your people call his people? I don't think so. I believe that his plan and purpose, that he actually has a really strong, powerful, poignant plan and purpose for each and every person in this room here today. And he calls out to us daily. And yet sometimes we just choose not to listen. And don't forget, the cost of following Christ is high. But the value of being Christ's disciples is even higher. See, don't forget, this is an investment that's not temporary. This is an investment that will last eternity. And I promise we'll provide remarkable, incredible rewards. The decision to follow Jesus should not be put off. Even though other loyalties may compete for our attention, nothing should be placed above a total commitment to living out a life for him.
Amen. After listening to Larry's message, our walk with God is us. who stands behind that podium, I don't see that it doesn't make a difference, but it is our personal walk that is important. And I'm going to go ahead and use this. This is the 30th anniversary of Back to the Future. Now, why am I bringing that up? You know, we could hop in the DeLorean and set the time circuits for almost 2,000 years ago and go back. Why? Wouldn't it be cool if we could actually walk and talk with Jesus and listen to his teachings? Now, that's not possible. We can't actually do that. But soon, in the perspective of history, we will have a chance to go to heaven. Soon, and maybe very soon, we will go to meet the King. What a day. We stand and sing with us in song.
Walk with Christ, that matters. In his name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen.